Hi pharmacology students, this is Dr. Herndon again. In today's video, I'm going to be talking about pharmacodynamics and some other really important pharmacology stuff. Pharmacodynamics is the study of the mechanism by which drugs produce physiologic changes in the body. Drugs can affect the activity of a cell or a tissue by combining with cellular receptors on the cell membrane in order to change the cell's function. When drugs combine with receptors, they can increase or decrease cell activity. Some examples are increasing or decreasing cell secretion, depolarizing neurons, or increasing muscle cell contractions, and therefore create different effects on the body. Now let's look at what's called the lock and key model, which describes how drugs interact with cell membrane receptors in order to exert their effects on the cell. In this model, the drugs interact with only specific receptors, much in the same way a key will only fit with specific locks. The tendency of a drug to combine with its receptor is called its affinity. The ability of a drug to produce a desired effect on that cell is called its efficacy. So look at the picture on the top. You can see how the drug molecule, which kind of looks like a Lego, fits perfectly with the drug receptor in that it fits together and the drug is going to have an effect on that receptor and cause some sort of cellular action. So this particular drug has excellent affinity for the receptor and it's going to create an action or has excellent efficacy. In the second picture down there, you can see the drug molecule fits somewhat with the receptor. There's a couple of spots there that fit. So it has pretty good affinity, but maybe it needs that third little triangular piece in order to have good efficacy. So this drug has good affinity for the receptor, but maybe poor efficacy. And on the bottom there, that drug molecule with the one little half circle fits in the receptor a little bit, so it probably doesn't have very good affinity, but maybe it blocks the receptor altogether. So it may not have good efficacy, but it may be great at actually blocking that receptor from anything else attaching to it. Now let's look and see how a drug can act on that receptor. It can act in one of three ways: as what's called an agonist, as a partial agonist, or as an antagonist. A drug agonist is one that has a high level of affinity for the receptor and a high level of efficacy, and it causes a specific action or some observable effect on that cell. So a drug agonist must occupy the receptors and activate them in order to produce some effect. A drug that acts as what's called a partial agonist has less affinity for the receptor, though it will interact with it, but it's going to have poor efficacy as a drug, so it's not going to have as many cellular effects. Now, a drug antagonist is one that might interact with the receptor or maybe some other part of the drug mechanism, but has no activity against that cell or produces no cellular effect. It actually can also inhibit the action of an agonist by blocking that receptor entirely. Now let's look at two types of drug antagonism: competitive versus non-competitive antagonism. Competitive antagonism, also called reversible or surmountable antagonism, is based on the fact that the drug antagonist vies with a drug agonist or a neurotransmitter or something for the receptor to which both have equal affinity. In non-competitive antagonism, also called irreversible or insurmountable antagonism, the antagonist permanently combines with the receptor or for a prolonged period of time in such a way as to block that receptor or change it so that nothing else can bind. Another example of the way that a drug can affect the cells of the body is called chemical antagonism. This is a process by which a drug antagonist does not combine with the cell receptor itself, but instead with the agonist itself. A good example is EDTA, which stands for ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid. This is a chelating agent which takes up certain metal ions and calciums, and one of the ways it can be used is for the treatment of certain heavy metal poisonings, because it'll take up like mercury or something like that and prevent it from damaging cells. EDTA is also used in certain types of blood collection tubes to chelate the calcium and prevent the clotting mechanism from occurring. It's important to mention that some drugs can have an effect on cells and tissues without ever combining with cell receptors. These are called non-receptor-mediated actions. Some examples of substances which don't need to combine with a receptor are osmotic diuretics, saline cathartics, antiseptics, or urinary acidifiers. In these cases, the drug itself may change the pH or kill surface bacteria or cause some sort of osmotic change without directly affecting the cell. So a drug can affect a cell by either stimulating it or depressing it. It can irritate the cell or it can actually even cause the cell to die. It's important to remember that no drug produces only a single effect. We can look at what's called the dose-response relationship by plotting a simple XY graph of the increasing dose on the X-axis versus the measured response of the patient on the Y-axis. And in general, as the drug dose increases, there is an increase in the response of the patient until a maximum response or a plateau is achieved, and then above which we start to see adverse effects to the point where we could even see patient death. Now, let's use alcohol as an example of a dose-response relationship and look at it on the curve. Alcohol is a small lipophilic molecule that can easily pass the blood-brain barrier and affect neurotransmitters in the brain, both in an excitatory manner and in an inhibitory manner, depending on the dose. In very small doses, maybe like a couple sips of alcohol, a person might not feel any effects at all. After a few more drinks, a person might feel giddy, as the alcohol is stimulating certain parts of the brain. If you have a few more drinks, a little bit larger dose, the depressive effects take over and the person might start feeling sleepy. In even larger doses, the person might fall asleep and enter a state of deep sleep brought on by the depressive effects on the brain. You might know this state as being passed out or blackout drunk. At some maximum dose of alcohol, the person might be passed out or in a state of deep sleep and then have labored breathing due to the depressive effects of the alcohol in the brainstem. Eventually, alcohol levels above a certain toxic level can actually lead to death. Now let's look at another pharmacologic concept. It's called the therapeutic index of a drug. The therapeutic index of a drug is a relationship between a drug's ability to achieve the desired effect on the patient compared to its tendency to produce toxic effects on the patient. So it basically quantifies the drug's margin of safety or window of safety and is expressed as a ratio between what's called the LD50 and the ED50 of the drug. Where the LD50 is the dose of a drug that is lethal in 50% of animals, and the ED50 is the dose of a drug that produces the desired effect in 50% of animals. Certain drugs have what's called a narrow therapeutic window or narrow margin of safety, and this just means that the lethal dose is very close to the effective dose, so that these drugs must be administered with a lot of caution. Some examples are chemotherapy drugs. They have a narrow margin of safety. Now let's look at the therapeutic range of a drug. This is the ideal drug concentration in the body. A drug concentration can be measured in the plasma or in the urine, sometimes in the CSF. This graph demonstrates a plasma drug concentration versus time in hours. As you can see, a drug level below the therapeutic range is ineffective, or maybe it doesn't have any effects on the body. There's a certain level at which that drug is in the therapeutic range and it has effects on the body, and then above which the effects are going to be toxic. Now, every drug has what's called a half-life or a T1/2 in the body, and this is the time it takes for the concentration of a drug in the body once it's reached its peak to be decreased by 1/2 of its concentration. A half-life of a drug determines the duration of action after a single drug dose and the time required to reach what's called steady state, which we'll look at next. And also it determines how frequently we give a dose of that drug or the dosing frequency. There are some things that can actually increase the half-life of a drug or allow it to stay in the body longer. One example is liver disease, where maybe the drug's not being metabolized properly, or kidney disease, in which the drug's not being excreted at a normal rate. Steady state, or the distribution equilibrium of a drug, is the time after which the peak and trough drug concentrations in the body remain consistent, or the point at which drug accumulation in the body equals drug excretion by the body. As you can see in this graph, it's typically about 4 to 5 half-lives. In order for a drug to be effective, drug levels must accumulate in the tissues or fluids at a therapeutic range. In order to maintain body fluid or tissue drug concentrations, the drug must enter the body at a rate that is balanced by the rate at which the drug leaves the body. And this is controlled with drug dosages and drug dosing intervals. Things like organ failure can delay the time it takes for the drug to leave the body, and something like diuresis, where there's an increased production of urine, can actually speed up the time it takes for a drug to leave the body. In addition, age of the patient is going to have a lot of effect on tissue concentrations of drugs. In a young animal, maybe their liver metabolism is not mature yet. They may have less body fat relative to body water. And same as in an older patient, where maybe their body fat, body water levels are different, and their metabolic rate may be different. Liver, kidney function maybe is altered. So the age of a patient is going to have a lot of effect on drug distribution as well.